Hello and welcome, everyone. Thank you so much for joining me for another episode of the New Construction Marketing Podcast. I'm your host, Anya Krisanthan, and I'm very excited to introduce our guest for today. His name is Patrick Moss, and Patrick is a consultant. He's a founder and a CEO of CPI, and his company works to transform sales and marketing as well as customer care experience. So I thought it would be really cool to have Patrick on the show today to share his wealth of knowledge with us, because he's really on the frontier of the new age selling, so to speak. So, and Patrick also is an author and a speaker. He has a book out. It's called Disruptive Selling, and I can't wait to get into it with Patrick. So welcome to the show, Patrick. Thanks so much for being here today.
Thank you, Anya, thank you for having me. And I'm looking forward to share some of my ideas on how the selling process and the customer engagement process is changing and will certainly change in the near future.
Great, and it definitely seems to be moving at the speed of light. Customers are all expecting, the Amazon service. And especially in our building industry, it can be challenging to provide Amazon service. So, Patrick, we usually like to start things off by getting to know you a little bit. So if you don't mind taking us through kind of your progression through your career, how did you get into what you do now, and, the whole story?
Okay, very good. I'll try to keep it as brief as possible. But I started out many years ago as an employee in a bank. That wasn't really my environment, but I had the chance of going through all the departments and learning how a bank functions. From banking, I moved into advertising, which was much more to my liking, much more exciting. I worked there in the creative department as a copywriter, but I also did a period in sales, business development. And it is in my business development period that I wanted to find another way of selling, of really getting close to the decision makers and speeding up the selling process. So I think the same challenge that every salesperson has. So I started interviewing a number of CEOs about what they saw as the key elements of success in building their company. Of course, things came out about sales and marketing and customer engagement and products and pricing and distributors and all those things. But what I had expected, like exceptional advertising, was on the list, but it was way down on the list. But those people told me very interesting things. So I told them, when you spend time with me for a work session, an hour, to share your thoughts, I will get back to you when I have talked to your colleagues. It was a kind of a bucket list. I had 10 CEOs on there that I wanted to interview because they were also interesting for each other. Mm-hmm. So after some time, I've interviewed them all. I went back to them. And I shared my insights, and they said, oh, this is interesting. Wouldn't you like to do some work sessions with us to explore all these things? Mm-hmm. And I went back to the advertising agency where I worked, and I said, well, I think I have something fantastic. But my boss at that time didn't share his enthusiasm, because he said, yeah, it's a completely different thing. Consulting is something else. We are not that much into that. It's a completely different business, and it's also very hard work. And you will discover in the rest of your life that it is a different thing to do. But if you want to do it, if you like it, you just should go ahead. So they supported me also because I could use the office there to start up. And I was very lucky because in the first 2 or 3 weeks, I got some clients that stayed with me for for the rest of my life until now. Wow. And some of them were investment companies, so it's very interesting. They buy a company, and when they consider to buy a company, it needs to be screened. Mm-hmm. Also some international companies that were globalizing, that did continuous takeovers. And companies that need to be taken over need to be integrated. Mm-hmm. And preferably in a way that you keep the best elements of both worlds. So from there on, my focus was on how do these companies operate sales, marketing, customer service. Mm-hmm. And I developed several screening models for that. And based on the screening models, I developed solution frameworks. And so I built a reputation as a consultant in Europe. And I did some work outside Europe, in Asia and in the US, but it was very, very limited. Mm-hmm. But in 2005, I wanted to scale. And so I started hiring people. So today we are 25 people.
Wow.
And we have three departments. We have a consulting department. So people look into how is the selling process organized, what can be improved. Also looking at extracting data from the selling process. Because if we have data, we can construct the way things really are. And we do a lot of process mining. So going into the data and to reconstruct the real engagement patterns, which are very often different from what you will find on the flowchart, the way it should go. Mm-hmm. So next to that, we have a technology department. So our technology people are working on everything which is CRM, marketing automation. And we also started 2 years ago building websites because we felt that the website is part of the sales approach. Mm-hmm. And the website also takes over a large part of the traditional selling process. Yeah. And it becomes a lead generation machine. And a good website can also be used by the salespeople to support their own process and so on. But it was very difficult each time to brief web agencies. It took a lot of time. It wasn't always what the client expected, what we wanted to see. So we started getting creative people on board. We started getting developers on board. And today, every year, we build something like 10 to 15 websites, and we put a lot of technology in there. Mm-hmm. And then we have a creative department, a very small team, but very good people who can really visualize everything. So they are into video, they are into images, they are into very nice flowcharts and so on. We use this also in our consulting processes. Mm-hmm. So from our first collaboration with the client, we start to challenge the value proposition. So what is the story you're telling, and are you sure that the story is sufficiently different from what others tell? Are you really hitting the right button with the customer to get attention and stuff like that? And while you're discussing, instead of making a big slide deck and then discussing it again and then taking months to do something, we have all the three departments working concurrently. So this makes it possible for us to look at any company and to completely renovate the selling approach in a minimum of 3 months, but a maximum of a year. Wow. And so we do this in a lot of industries, going from really technical products, like people who sell glass factories, so the entire plant, to people who sell industrial components, to people who sell software. We have clients in food. We have a very nice brand of gin.
Yeah, we have
clients in cosmetics. We have clients in chocolate, of course, as a Belgian company. So basically, our approach is applied in any industry. And that is also the fun of my job, and that's also what I see with the people that we have here today in the team. It's you told me in our when we talked before the podcast here, it's about giving back. Mm-hmm. And I always felt that a good relation as a consultant with a company, it goes about both ways, because you try to help the company to grow or to achieve specific goals. But every process you do, you get something back. And of course, you get money. That is the traditional for consulting. But what you also get is you get to share the passion of those people to build their business. you get really behind the screen insights of their successes and their failures. You get to understand their production processes, and you see how they run their company. And so it is a very gratifying job. And I observed around 2014 that there were some really fundamental changes going on in the way, not so specifically how people sell, but in how people buy. And sometimes people say it's a difficult, customers are getting difficult and they're demanding so much, they all want Amazon Prime level service and so on. But there are a number of reasons for that. And there is not much choice for a company. You need to adapt. And there are ways to find a good equilibrium between what the customer needs and wants and how you can deliver it. And that's what the book is all about.
Yes, so disruptive selling. Thank you so much for writing that book. And so you said that there are some fundamental changes that are happening. So why do you think those changes are happening? Is it because of technology, or why do you think that this is taking place?
Well, the first, and I think it's one of the crucial elements, I think is that people are much more busy than they were ever before. And there are different angles to this. One of the elements is that you can say, and there are studies about this, that the attention span of people is diminishing. In the book, I tell the story of a study that's been done comparing the attention span of a human being to the attention span of a goldfish, a guppy. And when they did the study the first time, the human attention span was around 12 seconds that you focus on something before thinking about something else. And the goldfish is around 11 or also around 12. And every year it is decreasing. And today, young people, and for me, everybody who is younger than 14 years old is young. It's a definition. But there, the attention span is down to 2 seconds.
Wow, and that is crazy.
And you know, it comes from having so many impulses from your social media and so on. And when I first did presentations about this, because it's one of the core concepts of our methodology, this reduced attention span, people said, oh, it's a drama, the world will go down the drain, people will not be able to focus anymore. I said, no, it's not a problem. It is something, you can see it like a Darwinistic evolution. It is something people have developed a defense system. And they have learned to scan information much more rapidly than the older generations. And they know how to distinguish between that information something that may be interesting. So the way it works is within those 2 seconds, and it will get faster and faster over time, of course, they scan, and if you have young people in your environment, just look how they go through their Instagram and through their Snapchat and so on. It is not like they're going like that. No, no, they're going up high speed, and then they stop up, and then they go again. And it is something they do intuitively, but they register. So what happens if in the 2 seconds you catch attention, then you are on, I think the English word is probate, like in the, you have 15 seconds to prove that you have something interesting to tell.
Okay, so this is very important, because we know that in real estate in general, a majority of home searches start online. So people are looking online. So that means if you have 2 seconds to catch somebody's attention, especially with homes, like people are so visual. So that means you have to put your best foot forward, and you must have great photography, great video, right? Something that's going to catch their attention. You can't just take pictures with your iPhone and hope that this catches somebody's attention. So yes, that's very important, because once you catch somebody's attention, and you have to think about what, right? Who's your ideal customer and what's going to catch their attention? So is it a picture of the kitchen you're going to put out, or is it a bathroom, or is it a playroom that you're going to show them, right? So that they pause and actually spend the 15 seconds looking at it.
Absolutely. Yes. And it is also important, and then it's a little bit about technology. When people do go online, and it is for many things, it is 70%, 80%, some things like search of a new home. Mm-hmm. It's probably very close to 100%. There aren't many people anymore that actually go out and look at the shop window to see what is there for sale and so on. They may see a billboard or they may see a television commercial, but then still they will go to the website. And then, of course, if you have a website that isn't mobile, because most of those things are studied on a smartphone,
yes.
If it isn't mobile, if it isn't loading fast, if there is too much information, if it isn't well legible, if the picture quality isn't good, if you are not showing the right things, like, as you say, the kitchen, the bathroom, the garden, the angle, or whatever, then you won't pass the 2-second threshold.
Yeah.
But then, after that, you have 15 seconds. And we have clients in real estate in Holland, because we work all over Europe. Mm-hmm. And we have a big group of real estate brokers in Holland. And they are with, for Europe, it's big, 180 people and so on. So they do quite a lot. There we see that if you attract something and people click, and then sometimes on a website, you have a very good first image. Mm-hmm. But then the rest of the site, of the pictures you're showing, is bad quality.
Mm-hmm.
And you're in trouble, because the way it goes is you have 2 seconds to catch attention, and then you have 50 seconds, but the 15 seconds are your window to prove that that the decision to allow you exposure was the right one.
Mm-hmm.
And there are surveys that indicate that when people allow you the 15 seconds and they're disappointed, they remember. They will say, this is really not a good party. So you're on the blacklist.
Wow. Yeah. So that they make, I know when people are searching on a website, they're not looking to select you. They're looking to eliminate you. I've heard that before. So I guess what we can learn from this is that it's very important to be almost uniform. So say with the real estate, there's different types of sites where consumers can start searching. And so when, say, they found you on Zillow, if they are then going to your website, that website needs to be very similar as far as the style of the website, maybe even the font of the website, that they're getting similar experience, because that's what they're expecting. So that if their expectation is different from what they experienced in the first place, they are saying, okay, no, this is not for me. Now, how does it translate to, now we actually, we're lucky enough that this person said, okay, I'm interested, I want to see more, and now they're coming into your model home. So how important is it to continue that same experience in the model home that they experienced on your website?
Yes. So the first thing is the attention span. The second thing is the expectation to be entertained. Mm-hmm. And expects to be entertained at every touch point. Now, one of the things that is essential, and I think it is something that every salesperson and every marketing people today is doing, is considering the customer journey.
Yes.
And if they are not, they should absolutely start with this, just mapping out visually what are the touch points of a customer and a potential customer with your company. Mm-hmm. And it can be touch points with websites, it can be touch points with customer support, but also with salespeople. And one of the touch points will be the visit to the test home.
Yes.
But the expectation today is that the emancipated customer
expects... Love that term. Yeah, emancipated like customer.
Yes, so the emancipated customer, when they do an effort, they expect something in return. And another element is, of course, that the selling process is less and less based on face-to-face and real human interaction.
Yes.
So we do a lot of studies in how huge organizations can increase their operational efficiency in mm-hmm. sales. And then, of course, if people do the work themselves, they go to the website, they look at the video, all those things cost not so much for the company. Mm-hmm. And then they say, well, in the end, if we can do the selling process in such a way that the customer pushes a button and say, I buy, mm-hmm. Then it's for some companies considered as ideal. Now, luckily for people that are in sales, there are not many sales processes except from buying books and a lot of commoditized stuff and so on, some fashion, in which the human contact is really not necessary. Mm-hmm. And then you see that human contact is valued by the customer.
It is valued, you're saying. It is valued.
It is valued. And when they have this human contact, going to the home to see what it is all about, meeting the sales rep. For them, they have been in touch with your company for probably weeks or months.
Yes.
Very often, there are statistics about that, but most of the time, the customer will already have done 70% of the exploration. So they will have been a zillion times on the website and all those things. Mm-hmm. So for meeting people, representatives of the company, is an event.
Yes.
It should make it memorable.
Okay. So I have a couple of questions for you. So I guess number one, when we were taught to sell, and I would say really in a building industry, there was a lot of emphasis on keeping your customer in the model home for as long as you possibly can. So it was like, you know, you take them through the whole process, you show them the home, you then try to identify the model that they're interested in, and you try to pinpoint the home site, and then you try to get them to sit down with you to go through the whole cost estimate, which could take literally hours. So what's your take on the keeping the customer as long as possible in front of you? Is it still relevant, or do you think it's going to work against you now when we live in such a busy society that, you know, I'm busy. I may have my Saturday, Sunday. I'm going to go see so many different builders. I can spend half my day with you. And is that actually going to turn me off as opposed to sell me on it?
A very interesting question, because there are a lot of elements in there that I would like to talk about. Mm-hmm. One of the essentials of the new selling is that you have to accept all the time that the customer is in the leads. So that means you can no longer push or hunt the customer in the traditional way. So you should not, when a customer comes in and has used a couple of minutes or your time or a couple of hours, that doesn't mean that a contract has been signed or a commitment from the client is there. Because some salespeople still consider a client as something to hunt.
Yes. Huh?
And they also use the terminology, yeah? Because I think one of the problem in introducing the new selling is less with salespeople, but is more with sales managers and trainers. Mm-hmm. Because some of the sales managers still ask salespeople to push and to hunt and to chase. And this is so dangerous, because I think that when the customer makes the effort to come to the home, mm-hmm. I think you should make it a memorable experience. And if you do it well, the customer will be happy, will be entertained, will be impressed. But of course, only mm-hmm. if what you're selling is a good product or is in line with what the customer expects. It is no longer that you can sell a bad product with a good sales talk.
Right.
The other thing is that also you should respect the customer and the customer's agenda. So really like locking the door so that the customer can't get out.
Now.
taking too much the lead in the selling process. This morning I was discussing with a company and they said, yeah, we have big difficulties in selling our products lately. And then I said, yes, okay, but can we then ask some of the salespeople just to come in and let's do like we are customers that they're going to meet the first time. So, and let's say, let's give them 15 minutes. I just want to see the beginning. And we also tell them that they just have 15 minutes. Mm-hmm. See how they react. And now there were two things that were happening. One of them was that all of them came in with a computer. They opened it, so they put the computer between us and the and them. Mm-hmm. And that started taking us to a PowerPoint. So in the 15 minutes were there, their story wasn't finished. And they didn't ask any questions. They didn't ask for our input. And we were taken through a journey that wasn't our journey. Everybody would have preferred to say, well, I have this context, and can you tell me something about this, something about that? Mm-hmm. If we ask questions, it was, yes, it will come, it's later in the PowerPoint. There were also some people who were clearly trained by some kind of madman sales consultant who came in and he said, yes, basically, sir, but if you only have 15 minutes, we will reschedule this.
What? No, you don't reschedule.
Then I said, well, this is great. So, okay, but you don't need to reschedule. You're off my list.
Right.
And then you get all these traditional trained stories like, yes, but you have to understand we need an hour or we need half an hour. And you really like it as, hey, today the world is like, it's basically, it's like Tinder, eh? But you're flipping left, right. And you're doing exactly the same with your sales. So it is about likability. It is you have all the traditional things, huh? You need to prepare, you need to be on time, you need to have the right things, you need to think about your sales story. Mm-hmm. But today the customer is in the lead. So if the customer comes in 10 minutes late and says, I only have 10 minutes, then you should be glad that the customer is there in 10 minutes. If you only have 10 minutes, let's discuss how I can help you. And this is really also another concept of the new selling. Mm-hmm. The new selling is about helping a customer to come to the right decision. Mm-hmm. It is no longer pushing the customer to a signature. And I know, of course, that if you're in sales, and I was in sales myself for some time, mm-hmm. If you need to get to meet a target at the end of the month, if the factory needs your order and so on, okay, you are tempted to push. Mm-hmm. But it is completely wrong because you will build the wrong kind of reputation. In the new selling, what you need is you need more leads. Mm-hmm. Because if you have more leads in the beginning of your sales funnel, mm-hmm. then you have more potential and then you will be able to sell in a much more relaxed way. Mm-hmm. And of course, it goes both ways because customers have less time, mm-hmm. their attention span challenged, but also the expectation of salespeople is that they will see much more clients in a day. So one of the things is, and there virtual reality comes in and video comes in and 360 comes in and all those things. I think it is a legitimate question for a salesperson in your industry to think about, okay, today we need 1.5 or 2 hours. Okay, is this really useful for the customer? And is it useful for me and for my company? Because in many companies, selling has been replaced by customer success approaches. And if you are online, then at a certain point you are tracked or you ask a question or whatever, and then people start reaching out to you and they say, why don't we schedule a 15 minute, a 10 minute, a 5 minute, a 7 minute conversation via GoToMeeting, Skype, Zoom, whatever. And that is not bad. Because those people, they are able to do 24 to 36 customer contacts a day. Mm-hmm. And they just use that to understand what the customer needs. And then they say, okay, well, in your case, I think it is really important that you come over. I really would like to invite you. Mm-hmm. We have several possibilities. We can do a full tour, and I can show you this, I can show you that. It will take 1.5 hours of your time. Of course, we'll provide you coffee and a sandwich and everything. But then the customer says, yeah, but 1.5 hours is difficult. I only have 10 or 15 minutes. Because, and then if the customer says, because I want to see some of your competitors, nothing wrong with that. Another principle of disruptive selling is, of course, the total transparency. The market via the internet and so on is transparent. So people will compare. So yeah. To prevent that, keeping the customer locked up in your home for 2 hours, making sure that he won't have time to visit a competitor.
Not a good strategy, huh? Yeah. So talking about this, Patrick, really gets me thinking. So you're saying, okay, total transparency. So I think more and more important, because the customers are going to expect the information from the builders. And a lot of times the sales reps keep it very tight. Because, for example, pricing for options. A lot of times they're not going to give it out to the customer unless they sit down with you. So I think in this case, it's going to backfire, right? Because nowadays the expectation is, I want transparency. I want to be able to see that information. And two, what I'm thinking is because they've spent so much time online looking at your house, looking at your property, chances are, like you said, they're 70% there, and they just need to reaffirm their decision when they're coming into your model. So you play a huge role. So you guys, I visited a community over the weekend. It was an open house, and literally I came into the model home, and before the sales rep even said, hello, so happy to see you, thank you for coming in, it was, put the booties on right now. And I was like, whoa, like, yes. Hi, nice to see you too, you know. So I was so taken aback by, like, there was not a warm greeting. It was like, put those booties on right away, that, and such a sour attitude that I was like, if I was a customer, like, there's no way I would have buy from this person, no matter how beautiful this house was. So it's just the importance of how important it is to make the first impression. First impressions are crucial, and they're going to be lasting impressions. And the whole idea of I'm in control, right? Like controlling the customer, that is done. There's no controlling the customer. So you have to be able to go with the flow. And obviously you never want to stop the process, right? You never want to be the one like, well, you know, you said 15 minutes, so go off now. You want to, you know, if there's the next step would be this, would you like to go ahead and do that, so that you leave it up to the customer to make the decision?
There's an important thing that may be interesting to talk about a little bit, is that one of the conclusions is that in the new selling, the selling process is no longer linear. Because in the old selling, it was a process you did 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 was signing the order or stopping and going to chase somebody else. Mm-hmm. Today, and I think that is something that is important in your industry, I think that the visit to the home should not be the end of the process. And I also think that it can, for different customers, play a different role. And the customer will choose where in the customer journey they choose to visit. And it is possible that you can try some customers to ask them to visit early for 15 minutes, follow them up, invite them again for another 15 minutes, and then before they sign the contract, do the full tour just to support your transparency and to do some upselling and stuff like that. An essential element is, of course, also that you are able to track what your customer is doing. Because we talked a little bit about technology in the beginning, and I told you that we are busy with those things. But I think also that most companies that are applying modern marketing and sales, they will track when customers are at their website, and they will know exactly what pages they're looking at, for how long, and in what order.
Yeah.
So it means that it is not because the customer leaves you without signing the order. It's not a drama. Because if you have a good marketing automation CRM, you will just see, in the next day, they looked again, twice at our website, they looked at those pages. And then the job of the salesperson is no longer just about talking. It is also about facilitating then the buying process. So every salesman should, or salesperson should have documentation and tools, video stuff that they can send based on what they observe as the rest of the selling process of the customer journey. And you can, of course, partly automate that process. You can say that, okay, hey, the customer came in, then he looked at some pages. Because he looked at some pages, he will receive a series of videos. He will receive, for example, an invite to visit the home again, but at night, or something like that, or in the evening, or in the early morning, if the light is good or whatever.
Yep.
But what you see in many companies is that still, even in a modern organization, that the salespeople are not informed. So it is important that a salesperson has also the possibility to contribute to the process.
Mm-hmm. So sales and marketing need to be working very closely together.
Yes. And in the old selling, the sales team or the salesperson was in the lead.
Mm-hmm.
From business development to closing, and marketing was somewhere there, printing the brochures and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
But today, it is important that the salesperson has what is called the single customer view.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the time via CRM, where they can see the customer that comes in. Before he came in, he looked at those pages at the website.
Mm-hmm.
The customer told something on social media about his impression or his intention.
Mm-hmm.
So then there is the talk, or the 15 minutes, the hour, the 2 hour, whatever you can make of it. And then you follow the rest of the journey, other impulses or sent videos and other invites. And then at a certain point, following the lead scoring, following the scoring of the opportunity, the salesperson gets a message like, hey, the person that was there 5 months ago for 15 minutes, you should reach out.
Yeah.
And reaching out is then with a high probability of moving further, not of signing, but of moving further. I say, hey, it's been some time. I have something new to show you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you're not being a stalker and saying, I saw you looked at page, ta-da-da, because that's creepy. You don't want to do that.
Hey.
And couple of interesting things you're saying here. So one, you're saying, so you really want to use that time addressing what customer wants. So, you know, you have those salespeople who talk a lot.
Yes.
It's like you come in and instead of them asking questions, they just dump this information on you. Dump and dump and dump. So you guys, it's very important that you don't dump information, and that basically you want to use the limited time that you have in asking all the right questions. You want to get as much information out of the customer as possible, so you know what the pain points are, what do they care about. And then two, again, automation. I talk about automation all the time, is that it's a key to have a CRM system that will allow you to automate it. And then, you know, you can do very personable videos, like say the customer leaves, and you know, you're going to be talking about the same things over and over again. So you can take the time, shoot a quick video saying, hey, I know you mentioned that it's important for you to have a worry-free lifestyle, low maintenance. So let me tell you about our warranty program.
Mm-hmm.
Go. And then you can send that same video. You can set it in your CRM system so that at some point it goes out to all of your customers if that is something that they're interested in. So you can do that with so many different things, and really, instead of holding the customer hostage in your model and talking about that warranty, you are sending it out, and if a customer is interested, they can watch the video, right?
And you will see when they have watched, because there will be a cookie or a pixel there. So you know, it's the same like most companies today, when they make proposals, they send the proposal electronically.
Mm-hmm.
So company knows when the proposal has actually been opened.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a reading tracker in there, so what parts has been read. Very often you see that the first thing customers go to is the price or stuff like that. Huh? So it's, but the interesting thing here is that marketing sales together with technology, it's really a combination that can be used to make the sales process much more efficient, but at the same time, to deliver a better customer experience to your client or your prospective client. You said salespeople sometimes talk too much. One of the things that I learned in a very old sales training was that there's a good reason why we have two ears and one mouth. And because if it was meant in another way, we would have had two mouths and one ear.
Yes.
what we see today is the emergence of sales coaching technology. Mm-hmm. And very often it is based on analyzing by professional specialists, but also with artificial intelligence, natural language analytics, and so on, what is going on in sales conversations. Mm-hmm. And so there is one company, one of our absolute favorites. It is called Gong.io.
I'm sorry, what is it called again?
Gong, G-O-N-G, and then .io. And Gong.io is absolutely a favorite of us. We discovered them when they were just starting up. So what they did is they looked at a recording of 27,000 conversations on GoToMeeting.
Huh.
And so salespeople talking to their customers via GoToMeeting. And then they had the team of linguistic specialists, sales coaches, psychologists, and so on, looking at it, trying to see patterns that work, because they linked it to being successful, successful closing, or moving significantly forward in the selling process.
Mm-hmm.
And then they started offering it first as a post-conversation analytics tool. So you install Gong.io, you do your conversation with your customer, and the full conversation is recorded. And then after the conversation, there's a dashboard. And the dashboard shows you how much time you talked and how much time the customer talked. Very interesting. But it also shows the key points that you touched, because the words that are used in the conversation, they trigger the visualization of a sales conversation timeline.
Mm-hmm.
So you can see, like, hey, you started the conversation discussing features, benefits, then you talked price, then you talked ordering conditions, and so on. And after that, you get feedback like, hey, your conversation was, compared to what we see as best practices, this and this was okay. There you can improve. And now it is moving up to the next level. The next level is now that these things go live. So during your conversation, you get on your computer screen a lot of instructions.
Oh, okay. I don't know if I could handle that. That would be distracting, wouldn't it?
Yeah, because one of the things we work with a lot is another thing. It is called Cogito. Cogito is a company that works on the sound, not the sound. It's the trembling of the voice. And so based on that, the system can detect if somebody is comfortable, if somebody is anxious, if somebody is stressed. And so while you're talking, on the right-hand side of your screen, you may get really some traffic lights moving in. And when you're doing really well, so you're on a roll in your conversation, green traffic lights move in. And when you're talking too much, when you're talking too fast, when you're overruling what your customer is doing, red traffic lights start to move in. So this is also the future of selling. But all those platforms and all that kind of technology is also there to help you respect the customer.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah. It's also so powerful to make things happen, because you will have your debriefing with, in the past time, the sales manager once a week or once a month. Now you can have it live or after every conversation.
Mm-hmm. I think that's great. So for the building industry, we do have secret shoppers, and your sales manager can hire a company to secret shop you. And I think that is something that we should do more of in the sales industry, especially in the building industry, because I think there's nothing more eye-opening than to see yourself on video and interacting with the customer and what you're doing. I think you can learn the fastest by observing yourself outside of yourself. Yes. And I think there's going to be so many, ouch, oh my God, I can't believe I said that. Or even the way you dress, or the way you stand. There's so many different nuances that you can pick up. So maybe you guys can have a conversation with your sales manager and see if you can do a secret shopper to help you improve. So it's usually has such a negative connotation, you know, ooh, secret shopper. It's, but it's really a great tool to help you get better. So I love that. Yeah.
What we also see is asking customers, so from the company out, what their impression was of the contacts they were having with your company. Mm-hmm. So people go through the buying journey, and at a certain point they are in the house and so on. So that is one of the significant moments in the journey. So a couple of days later, or the next day, the company could reach out and say, hey, you've been, we're so glad that you have been in touch with our company. You started asking a brochure 3 months ago, then you had a visit here, you had a visit there, and you've asked information about that. Now, I'm not here to sell you something, but I just want to know, how do you experience working with our company? Are we sufficiently helping you to make the right decision? Are we doing things that really make you happy? Because that is our philosophy. Did somewhere in the process we do something where you felt, that doesn't feel the way it should be? That's also a very interesting one. And it also shows the customer that he's important, that you care.
I agree with you. And you know what else I love about surveying is that a lot of the times, so I actually use surveys as part of my follow-up, but I didn't send it from myself. I had it set up as it's coming from like another email address, basically. So that it's not coming from the sales rep, but basically to ask them about their experience, how interested are you in this particular community, and ask for feedback. Because a lot of the times the customer will not tell you truthfully what they think about this particular community, this particular home, but they may feel much more comfortable doing it when they're sharing it kind of like anonymously.
Certainly.
So I definitely use that, and I recommend that you guys do it. And you can have your sales manager send kind of like a quick follow-up email, especially when the customer is not responding to you. That's a great way to either move the sales process forward or to eliminate it and say, hey, you know what, this one is not our buyer. So
what we recommend is bringing the top people. You don't need to bring them in person, but you can automate part of it. Like the CEO or the founder of the company is reaching out. It should, of course, be a real mail address that you're using, but it could be one of the mail addresses so that the person's mailbox isn't completely full. But it could be a mail address, because some people or some clients may get a little bit unhappy and then start to spam the person. Mm-hmm. But the impact of that, like, hey, I'm reaching out to you. Wow, this is the actual founder who is asking me a question. And I just wanted to make sure that you're happy working with us.
Yeah, I love that. And you can even do it in the video too. Again, right, have him record a quick video saying, hey, this is so-and-so founder of whatever homes. You know, I started this company and yada, yada. I want to make sure all my customers are experiencing the best. So give us the feedback.
And you can go for personalized video.
Yeah.
We sometimes use that for business development purposes. We recently did one where we had a couple of hundred videos. So it was a 60-second message introducing the company and saying, okay, what we basically need to do now is we need to meet. and click here to meet. And then we had all the names of the people that were on the most wanted list. And then we had the sales director who was actually doing the reaching out to those top customers. We had her in a studio. So she recorded all the names. She said, hey, good morning, Frank. Hey, good morning, Ronnie. Hello, Lisa, and so on. So this is what she did for a whole day. She was very...
Oh, my God.
And then we brought it to the rest of the movie. So we had one recording with her where she did the rest of the conversation. Like, hey, I'm very...
That's awesome.
This company, and I do that, and so on. And at the end, it was really, but she was very good at it. And at the end, and it was, so basically, why I'm talking to you, and I only have 45 seconds, we need to meet. And it worked fantastic, because also in a technological field, we could bring it together, so that for a customer, they got the link, they click on the link, and somebody is there on the screen saying, hey, I'm Veronique, but we need to talk.
Mm-hmm.
It really worked.
I love it. And you guys, it's easier than you think. You don't need a crew of television producers following you around. You just need your smartphone. You have the camera, you have the technology, you know, put it on the stand, shoot a quick video, and upload it to YouTube, send a link to your customer. It doesn't cost you a penny, but I bet you'll see such a huge difference in your conversion rate. So I love that, Patrick. Thank you so much.
That is for us a little bit the formula of success of the new selling. It is respect your customer. It is prepare, because you need to know what your customer wants and does. Mm-hmm. It is creativity, and it is technology.
Yes.
And if you bring those four together, you have a toolbox that really allows you to sell without actually selling.
Selling. Love it. And when you can sell without selling, my gosh, right? Everyone wins with that. So I love that. Thank you so much, Patrick. I really appreciate your time today. It's been such a pleasure. And can you tell everyone where can we pick up a copy of your book?
Yes, you can order it on Amazon.
Great. And you guys, I will put a link to it so you can check it out. And Patrick, if somebody wanted to connect with you on social media, is there a particular place where you hang out more so than other places?
Yes, LinkedIn is the easiest for me.
Great.
But of course, you can also send me a mail, or you can call me, or we can schedule go-to meetings and Skypes. I'm very regular in the States because I'm still studying.
You're a student for life.
Yeah, I'm a student for life. So I'm on the ACE program, so of MIT, where you can follow for over a period of 4 years. You can bring together all your own executive programs, and some of them you can follow online. But for others, you need to travel to Boston.
Yeah,
I love the States. It's a bit different from Europe, but there are so much more possibilities in doing things. So you're lucky in a lot of aspects on technology and scale. So I also love to work in the States. So if there's opportunities, questions, just ask.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Patrick. I appreciate that. I'll link all of your information, and you guys see if you can catch Patrick when he's visiting US and next time. So, I'm sure there's going to be more genius coming out of you in the future. So maybe another book, and I'll love to have you on another show to see as the sales process progresses. And yes, any future changes, I'd love to get your perspective on that.
I'll keep you posted. I'm actually working on a new book, but writing a book is, it's always easy in the beginning. It becomes very frustrating and so on, but I'm working on it, and I've put a goal for myself that between 1 year to 18 months, there will be a sequel. Because 18 months is an eternity in the way things evolve. And there's so much to tell, there's so much to share. So there will be a new book, and you'll be amongst the first to learn about it.
Awesome, Patrick. I love it. I can't wait to hear all about it. Thank you so much. And I hope you have a wonderful weekend.
You too. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye.
Okay. Hey, thank you. Bye.